Addiction is a complex disease. It affects the functioning of the brain and the body. People abuse substances like drugs and alcohol for varied reasons. They engage in behaviors that become compulsive and often continue despite harmful consequences. How does harmful substance use and addictive behaviors damage the brain? Connecting Point's Ray Hershel sat down with an expert in the field, Dr. Ruth Potee, the Medical Director for Addiction Services for the Behavioral Health Network, to learn more about what drug use does to our brains and why people become addicted.
You know, I think for so long we have stigmatized people who struggle with a substance use disorder and acted as though they're just bad people or weak people. Yet all of us struggle. I mean, if we're being honest with ourselves, many of us eat too many calories. We turn to food or sugar for comfort. We all have behaviors that we're not so proud of that actually aren't healthy. And sometimes it's food, sometimes it's alcohol. And what we know as we know understand more about brain science is that with any substance, whether it's nicotine or marijuana or opiates or alcohol, you disrupt the neurotransmitters in the brain. Not any different than what might happen in the brain with anxiety, depression, another major mood disorder, or quite honestly, Ray, the way that transmitters can get interrupted in the pancreas that cause diabetes. So when you stop and think that the brain is an organ and things can go awry, how does that look any different than it does for the kidneys, the pancreas, or the heart? It is a disease. It's a disease that has many origins.
And in terms of damage to the brain, can you describe that? I know young brains are particularly susceptible, young people under the age of 21, for example. Talk about the physiology of that.
Yeah, so actually I would have said up until about age 25, the brain is fully developing up until the age of 25, and we know that addiction is considered a pediatric developmental disease. It starts while your brain is developing. If you ask somebody who struggles with a substance, how old were you with your first substance? Was it alcohol? Was it marijuana? Was it nicotine? How old were you? The average age of first use is between 12 and 13. And if you, there's almost nobody who says, oh, I started doing for the first time in my life when I was 30. It just doesn't happen that way. It starts and starts to groove down in the brain while the brain is plastic and developing. And one of the reasons I'm coming to West Springfield High School to talk about addiction and how the brain breaks with addiction is because I am one of many people who believes this is a preventable disease. If everybody had the knowledge that you and I have, this is a disease that doesn't have to exist.
That is, speaking of that event, it's going to be Thursday, January 23rd, West Springfield High School, 6 o'clock. You'll be speaking. What will your message be to the community at that point? What's the major point you want to bring home to them?
I think I would say the major point is the one you already brought up, that this is a preventable disease. I actually spend a lot of time talking about adolescent brain development and exactly what goes awry. I spent a long time talking about marijuana because marijuana has become a very normalized drug. In fact, if you ask the average young person what they think about marijuana, they'll say it's all good, it solves all my problems, it's legal, it helps me be better in the classroom, I'm a better athlete. And what they think they know about marijuana and what we understand as scientists and pediatricians and family doctor, there is a wide chasm between those two things. I spend time talking about vaping. As you know, people are, particularly adolescents, vaping both nicotine products but also marijuana products. I spend time talking about the opiate epidemic, alcohol use disorder. I cover, over a period of over an hour, most of the substances that we might struggle with.
We hear a lot about vaping these days. What do you see in your line of work about vaping, and how dangerous is vaping?
We have been seeing for the last 4 years a resurgence of a return to a nicotine addiction. It has been the fastest return to something that we've ever seen since we've been collecting data in the last 40 years. So our kids are so smart, and they had turned their back on nicotine. They're disgusted by cigarettes. If you ask the average young person what they think of cigarettes, they say they're disgusting, they're going to kill you, they cause bladder cancer, they're incredibly smart. And then this little cool high-tech device came along that the kids thought was just water vapor and flavor, yet lo and behold, the industry made it so that it wasn't that. It was often nicotine, other chemicals for which we don't understand how they impact the body. And our kids, a third of high school students are vaping routinely, and it's an incredibly addictive substance because none of it is inspected by the Food and Drug Administration. So a lot of it has nicotine in it, which is addictive.
What are the risk factors in terms of addiction? Why do people become involved in addiction? I know genetics is part of this, the equation too, but talk about the risk factors and how people get hooked on addiction.
I would say there's three, maybe four things that are the setup. Genetics is a big one. So if you have a parent or a grandparent who struggles, you have about a 50% chance of struggling with a substance use disorder yourself. And that's not your fault, right? You don't get to choose your parents or your grandparents. But I am a believer that talking to your kids about their genetic risk can help them make better decisions. The second one is exposing your brain while it's still developing. So starting any addictive substance during adolescence is the setup for further substance use. If you postpone your use of everything until after your brain is fully developed, age 24 or 25, the likelihood of developing an addiction is 2%. The third one that's really important is having a very traumatic childhood, having bad things happen to you that make you want to escape the feeling of those traumatic events. People will self-soothe, self-medicate with substances in order to numb out from trauma. So acknowledging what trauma does and getting our kids help for their trauma or their other mental health conditions, anxiety and depression, and our kids have more anxiety and more depression than we have also seen since we've ever recorded it, partly because kids are glued to their smartphones. Mm-hmm. And that interaction with a screen all the time is not a connection to another human being. They're being judged not just by their middle school friends or who's in their math class. They're being judged by the entire world when all they do is interact with that screen. It's very harmful to our kids' mental health.
I think you've made a point, too, in your research and in talks before that you talked about the legalization of marijuana, for example. Marijuana today is a different marijuana than it was years and years ago. Isn't it much more potent these days?
You know, the marijuana we had up until the early 90s was about 3% THC, which is the psychoactive cannabinoid in marijuana. And today, grown in the Pioneer Valley, most marijuana is sitting between 9% and 18% THC, and then it gets more concentrated. So when you buy a candy bar with marijuana, it might be 50 to 90% THC. I mean, that's like comparing Tylenol to morphine. They're not the same drug. Mm. And so the number of our young people who actually get addicted to marijuana is higher than we've ever seen. And people, kids themselves, will say it's not addictive. That's not true. Today's marijuana is more addictive than nicotine.
There are parents watching this program or going to the event in West Springfield on Thursday who are saying, when should I talk to my young children about these issues we talked about? How young should they start when they talk to their kids?
Yeah. Well, so here you and I already said the average age of first use is 12, 13, or 14. That's 7th and 8th grade. Mm. So really you should be having the conversation in 5th and 6th grade.
Before the 7th and 8th grade.
Before the 7th and 8th grade. I mean, you would have a conversation with a kindergartner about drugs, and here's how the conversation would go. If you ever found a pill on the ground, don't touch it, get an adult. That's a drug talk to a kindergartner. And it's a critical conversation because common drugs could kill a kindergartner. So that's a drug talk, right? It has to be age appropriate. But at 5th and 6th grade, that's when our kids are experimenting with vaping products. And so having a conversation that we don't know what's in this, lo and behold, it's actually harmful. You can succumb to peer pressure, but you could also be the kind of kid who says, I'm not going to do that. I want to protect my lungs and my brain.
Are there symptoms or physical evidence that a parent should be on the lookout for in terms of a young person perhaps getting into an addiction issue?
Yeah, it depends on the substance, which way I would say there's clues. Vaping, if we're going to take vaping as the most common substance of exposure at a young age right now, it all has a very strong smell to it. Mm-hmm. So one of the amazing things that Massachusetts did, both the legislative bodies and Governor Baker, is they have signed what no other state has done, which is we have banned all flavored vaping products in this state, including menthol. That's extraordinary. Having said that, there's a thing called a computer in your smartphone, and you can order anything online that will get shipped to you. So if you're walking into your kid's bedroom and it routinely is smelling like watermelon, bubblegum, vanilla, whatever it is, and it's very intense, my first thought would be, is my kid vaping at home? It could be that it's a plug-in candle, but it's concerning when that smell is everywhere.
And one final question before we close, and that is, one, a parent should never lose hope. There is hope and help out there for people who are addicted.
Yes, people get better. It's not easy, and it doesn't happen the first time, and it's never a straight path. It's a really messy path. These days, opiates are killing people. It's a deadly disease, and sticking by your kid and having hope is one of the best things you can do. It is devastating to families, though, and it's not easy sometimes to love somebody who struggles that much because they've done harm. Mm-hmm. They have done harm to your relationship with them, but also to society and to themselves. And it's, as a parent myself of three kids, it's just a devastating thing to watch. But don't lose hope, because people get better. With time, people can heal.